Hi everybody, Joe here again and welcome back. So in today's video, I'm going to continue on with part 3 of a 3-part series on sumps. I plan to show you how to build the 3 most common sumps based on the method of filtration used. Now when it comes to methods of filtration, I break them down into the state the biological media is actually in, which is either submerged, emerged, or fluidized, meaning the media is below the water, above the water, or fluidized or constantly moving state. I plan to show you a basic layout on how to build one, some tips and ideas for them, how to size them for your aquarium, and the pros and cons to each method. With that said, last week we talked about the emerged filter. This week we're talking about the submerged filter. Now this is the most popular type of sump by far, largely due to its ability to be customized exactly to your needs. With so many combinations and ways to build a sump like this, I'm going to cover the basics while concentrating on the pros and cons. When it comes to a submerged sump, it's all about the baffles. Baffles are basically walls inside the sump that contain water and direct it. Placement of the baffles depends on what you're looking to do, however, we'll cover a basic layout of mechanical, biological, and equipment. First, we'll need to size the sump. The size of the sump should be large enough to accommodate equipment, media, and additional water that will drain when the power goes out. To figure out how much water will drain into the sump during a power outage, a simple rule of thumb that I use is to take the volume of the water your aquarium is and divide that by the height of the tank. For example, a 24-inch tall 100-gallon tank would drain around 4 gallons of water. Usually it's less, but it's a good start. Using the 100-gallon tank example, we'd use around 5 liters of appropriate media for it. We also know that around 4 gallons of extra space in the sump will be needed when the power goes out. Since a submerged media sump uses much less media than other methods, we don't need a huge amount of space. We just need to ensure that the media stays submerged, while there being enough room for equipment and additional water. Typically speaking, you can get away with a 20-gallon sump for every 100 gallons of tank. This is enough space for the equipment, media, and additional water added during a power outage. However, I really can't give you a rule of thumb because you may want to add more equipment or more types of media, or even more chambers. As with other sumps, I also recommend running a sump 6 times the volume of the system as a starting goal. Meaning that if your main aquarium is 100 gallons, you'll want to run the filter return pump at 600 gallons per hour. Baffles are typically siliconed in place and in the general formation that will allow water to flow under one and over the other. I tend to use movie or game cases to use as supports as it dries so I can get a consistency in height. This ensures that the water is forced through the media instead of just over it. You can use glass or acrylic, but I prefer to use glass for this method of sump simply because glass won't bow as much. This allows me to create multiple heights of baffles and different water levels in the tank. The thickness used depends on the difference in water level. The first section is important to add a good pre-filter, like some sponge, filter floss, or filter socks, whatever you prefer. The second chamber in this example will hold my biological media. Now typically in a submerged sump setting, the biological media of choice is something like ceramic media, sintered glass, lava rock, pumice stone, something with a lot of surface area. The last chamber will hold equipment like the pump and heater. However, before it, I add in an extra baffle. This will act as a bubble wall, meaning that the air bubbles will be removed here before being returned to the aquarium. It does this by making sure that the water overflowing into the last chamber has to once more flow down and under one more baffle before it gets pumped back to the tank. Now, the water flowing down means that any air bubbles that are being formed cannot flow under as the bubbles are forced to rise here. Now, this is an optional addition, however, it does come in handy if you don't want to have your main aquarium full of bubbles. Now, that's totally optional and typically more common in a saltwater tank than a freshwater. I also like to ensure all baffles are at least 1/2 inch from the top of the sump to allow them to overflow if one gets clogged. So there's many pros and cons to this type of sump. Now, the pros are that it's highly customizable. The possibilities are endless. They also tend to use a much smaller space than other types of sumps, and adds more water volume to the system since the sump is filled. However, some of the cons are that it can get expensive and tend to be the highest maintenance sump, meaning that you're going to spend more time taking care of this sump than any other. I would recommend this sump for people with limited space that want a highly customizable sump to perform many different duties to help contribute to a very efficient and purposeful filter. Anyways guys, I hope that you enjoyed this video and this 3-part series. I also wanted to thank you for watching and I'll see you guys next week for a new project.